Penguin Random House Audio presents DC Trip. This is the author, Sara Benincasa. For Gretchen Ray Bauer Stanford and Rachel Sivan Perry, who did nothing that resembles anything in this book, aside from being excellent friends then and now. And for three great high school educators who did nothing that resembles anything in this book, aside from being excellent role models, Ms. Jennifer Peck Nolte, Dr. William Fernickes, and especially my grandfather, the late great Joseph Donnelly. From Alicia Deats to Karen Henry. Subject: buckle up, it's gonna be a wild ride. Hi, Karen. You may be wondering why I'm sending this message to your private email instead of the school email, since it's about the sophomore class trip. I know we try to keep our faculty-mentoring relationship separate from our friendship, which is good because I doubt the principal would appreciate us hanging out in the faculty lounge and talking about how I got you high the night after your first faculty meeting in August. Nor does the principal need to hear us gossip about Hot Brad the yoga teacher at our new favorite studio downtown. By the way, did you know some people in Flemington still consider yoga to be a cult-like activity? Not the principal, obviously, but some of the parents. You'd think an upper-middle-class town in suburban New Jersey would be a little more educated about these things, but I seriously had kids' parents complain when I taught yoga workshops during gym class my first year. You may ask why the hell a social studies teacher would give up her free period in order to teach downward-facing dog to a bunch of hormonal beast children, but I wanted to be Little Miss Helpful. Those conservative parents still try to mess with my curriculum each year, and you should hear how they freak out about Patty Bump's Health and Human Sexuality course. I don't know how I ended up in the only consistently Republican county in New Jersey, but life takes us on weird journeys. Okay, so we haven't really gotten to talk about the sophomore class trip in person. You've been running around trying to be the perfect first-year teacher, in spite of my warning that this is a totally impossible task. You say yes to everything anyone asks of you, and I swear to goddess, by next year, I'm going to have taught you how to say no, Karen. But I get why you'd want to co-chaperone the sophomore class trip. I did the same thing my first year. It sounded fun. It was a chance to get out of the classroom and travel. And the stipend they offer you is surprisingly hefty. When I went on my first and to date only sophomore class trip, I was your age, 23. I was idealistic and hopeful and excited, just like you. And I'm not going to say that the trip diminished my love for teaching or for this school. In fact, some amazing things happened that changed my life in fantastic ways and made me love this gig even more. It was also a royal pain in the butt. You know those girls who visit me each year, the ones I introduced you to at Christmas? Gertie, Sivan, and Rachel? They were my favorite students my first year. They're still my all-time favorite students, although Katie Hank in third period rivals them in greatness. Well, turns out my favorite students were also my most mischievous ones. I just didn't fully realize it at the time because they hid some stuff pretty well. But a few years back, we all got drunk the day after Thanksgiving and they spilled everything. Everything. Then again, so did I. You know how I get when I drink. Anyway, in the interest of full disclosure and of hopefully protecting you from the rude awakening I got, I'm going to tell you everything that happened on my first and only sophomore class trip. You are to share this tale with absolutely no one. I 100% trust you, and not just because we have always spotted each other during handstand in yoga class. I suggest reading this with a glass of wine, not two or three glasses. A hungover trip chaperone is an unhappy trip chaperone. But one glass. Sip it slowly and savor the magic I'm about to drop on you. And in case anything crazy happens on your trip, don't say I didn't warn you. Love you, Alicia. Day one. By the time Gertie, Sivan, and Rachel got to school, the rest of the sophomores were already there. The other students were gathered in a pack on the front lawn of the school, listening to Mr. Kenner and Ms. Deats, so Gertie, Sivan, and Rachel hurried to catch up with them. "Ah, Gertrude Santanello Smith," Sivan Finkelstein, Rachel Miller, Mr. Kenner said, ignoring the horrified look on Gertie's face when he used her real name. How nice of you to join us.
It's my fault we're late, Mr. Kenner, Rachel said sweetly, batting her eyelashes at him. I'm really sorry. My mother was sick this morning, and I had to make breakfast for my father before he left for the church elders' committee meeting.
Gertie marveled at how easily a lie formed on Rachel's lips. They actually were late only because Rachel had taken forever to fix her hair. Sivan stared at the ground, because she wasn't good at maintaining eye contact with disapproving adults. She just wasn't used to it. Adult disapproval was a real rarity in Sivan's experience. Her professor parents adored her so much, they'd even started a P-flag chapter in her honor at their synagogue, which made Sivan deeply uncomfortable. Rachel wasn't particularly accustomed to adult disapproval either, but she had no fear of it. Not when she was sneaking out of class to blow football players in the bathroom, not when she was doing lines of coke off the actual altar in the chapel at church camp, and certainly not when she was 15 minutes late for a fucking school trip. Rachel had the kind of blonde hair and blue eyes and perfect skin and perfect tits that made her a standout in any crowd, and more than one good Christian son and father entertained impure thoughts as she stood in front of the huge megachurch congregation, singing a solo. Meanwhile, her parents beamed proudly from their seats, convinced their daughter was the most religious person since actual Jesus. Okay, Rachel, Mr. Kenner said in a way that made it obvious he didn't believe her. Well, you're all here, so let's get to the important stuff. All of you need to listen up and keep your eyes on me and Ms. Deats. That means you too, Sivan. Sivan looked up and nodded obediently. Of the three of them, Sivan was probably the one Mr. Kenner liked the most. As long as you tried hard in his class, he liked you, even if you weren't good at math. That's why he was most tolerant of Sivan, who tried very hard and happened to be great at math, too. Gertie gave it a reasonable shot and made B's, so she was all right by Mr. Kenner most of the time. Gertie gave everything in life a reasonable shot and played by the rules without fail. But Rachel doodled pictures of cute animals on her tests and never showed up for the early morning or after-school tutoring sessions Mr. Kenner offered. She also never did any extra credit assignments to bring up her grade. Therefore, he was obviously indisposed to any fondness toward her, though it seemed to bother her not one bit. Rachel found most men rather amusing, and Mr. Kenner was no exception. Then there was Ms. Deats, who was just a real sweetheart. She was nice to everybody, even the kids who were rowdy or disrespectful or made fun of her hippie jewelry. Today, she was in top 23-year-old hippie form, wearing a long flowing purple skirt, Birkenstock sandals, a t-shirt that read Be the Change, and big Native American dreamcatcher earrings that you just knew she'd bought on a reservation when she went for a sweat lodge ceremony or something where the locals charged the annoying tourists an exorbitant fee for an authentic Native experience. She was the kind of person who had a story about every article of clothing she wore. She'd tell you, too, if you so much as glanced at a chunky turquoise and silver bracelet or a rose quartz ring. Okay, students, Ms. Deats said, clasping her hands together and smiling brightly. You all know the three strikes you're out rule, but the principal requires us to go over it every single time we take you on a trip. She gave a little chuckle as if to indicate that she thought it was silly. That's because it's very important, Mr. Kenner said seriously, furrowing his brow. Three behavioral infractions and you're suspended. School trips require good behavior because you are representing Flemington High School to the entire world, especially in Washington, D.C. He glanced sideways at Ms. Deats. And there's an additional rule for this trip. She winced a little. Well, I'm sure it won't be a problem. We need to tell them anyway, Mr. Kenner said. Okay, Ms. Deats said reluctantly. Well, the principal has decided that any student who gets three infractions will not only be suspended from school, but will take summer school classes before being permitted to enter the junior year. This will go on your permanent record. The students looked at each other in disbelief. Some of them groaned. Others said, "What?" "That's not fair," Brooklyn said. She was standing with Peyton and Kaylee,
and they were wearing matching blue t-shirts.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.